That was a little muted. Let me do it this way. Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Tuesday, March 21, 2017 meeting of the Edina City Council. Roll call, please.
Member Brendel?
Here.
Member Fisher?
Here.
Member Staunton?
Here.
Member Stewart?
Here.
Mayor Hovland?
Here. We have in front of us this evening a form of meeting agenda. Is there anyone who wishes to modify the agenda in any form? All right. Hearing nothing, is there a motion to adopt the meeting agenda we have in front of us this evening?
So moved.
Second.
Got a motion and a second to adopt the meeting agenda as shown. Discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed say nay. Carried. Community comment. I see folks in the audience some we know, some we don't. Come on forward, folks. You'll have 3 minutes, I think. Ms. Benarot explained to all of you the rules around public participation. So, Mr. Grable, welcome.
Thank you, Mayor Hovland, members of City Council. My name is Floyd Grable. I live at 7510 Cahill Road, Edina 55439. I want to address you this evening concerning the recent search warrant discussed in Saturday's Star Tribune, and which was the subject of my letter to each of you dated 18 March. People say, if you have nothing to hide, then what's the problem with letting the cops look? Well, in my judgment, that is the language used by tyrants. Asking that question evidences a total lack of understanding of civics and our constitutional prerogatives and civil liberties. The Bill of Rights, the First Amendment, and the Fourth Amendment mean something and shall not and must not be ignored. Detective Lindman's warrant request with the support of the police department is a dragnet search designed to allow cops to search the computers of everyone in this room tonight, everyone watching this broadcast, everyone in the city and beyond. Dragnets are simply a violation of the Fourth Amendment prescription against unreasonable searches and seizures, as well as an attack upon one's First Amendment rights to read what they want without government snooping. In my letter to you, which I hope will be part of the record of this meeting, I ask two things of you. First, provide copies of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights to the members of the administration and the police department. The police were obviously not well informed as to the meaning of the First and Fourth Amendments. The police and prosecutor involved in the case appear to need a refresher. Had the application to the judge not been ex parte, perhaps the judge would have learned something about the amendments as well. Second, stop implementation of the search. You, as counsel, have the authority to direct the police to stop this search. To proceed is a violation of the Constitution and will only subject the taxpayers to wasteful expenditure of public money to defend against Google's promised court actions. The city's in a hole, and it's time to stop digging. Frankly, the police and the prosecutor who signed the application should be disciplined, and the judge who issued the warrant should be voted out of office. I'm a veteran. When I received my commission, I took an oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. One of the domestic enemies that we must guard against is Star Chamber prosecutorial and police overreach running roughshod over our civil liberties. This warrant is exactly the kind of overreach that should be condemned by anyone who believes in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Grable. Good evening.
Good evening. My name is William Rogers. I am a local attorney with many clients who live in common interest communities here in Edina. And I would actually like to draw the council's attention to item F on the consent agenda, which is a resolution 2017-29 supporting.
Mr. Rogers, you'll not be able to address. You'll not be able to address this matter.
Okay.
It's on the consent agenda. It's not a public hearing.
And, I stepped up so I could recommend that perhaps it be removed from the consent agenda, and commentary from the community, including multiple homeowners on this issue, might be heard.
they will not be heard even if it's removed from the consent agenda because it's not a public hearing matter. This is a matter for council discussion only, even if it's removed from the consent agenda.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Liz Keller, a resident of Edina at 5107 West 44th Street, zip code 55436. There will be two of us tonight speaking on this matter. Thank you for your time, Mayor Hovland, council members, and city staff. As a lifelong resident of Edina, my family and my husband and my children have lived in our home for 24 years on West 44th Street. Our neighbors to the west of us, the Wellness, have lived there 36 years, and Jim will be speaking. Our neighbors to the east of us couldn't come this evening, but they share this concern. While we understand that no parking on either side of West 44th Street from Browndale going west to Brookside Avenue is necessary, no parking signs on both sides of the street. Okay. The Edina city history has always allowed some exceptions to that, and the bagging of signs in unique circumstances and under special situations, always, until November of 2016, when this changed abruptly and, I believe, without notice. So there is no longer any exception to that for any of the residents who don't have parking along either side of the street on the street. So it restricts truly the use and enjoyment and even accessibility of our homes to family members, to holidays, to celebrations and gatherings. Personally, we can no longer host Thanksgiving dinners for our 30 plus relatives that we have historically done. We have a wedding shower scheduled in April. That's up for question as parking is no longer available. Thielen Avenue is kitty corner and across the street from us, and one of the city employees has suggested that perhaps we have overflow parking across the street and down Thielen Avenue. However, it is a problem. There's only parking on one side of Thielen. It's a very short street, and that parking is limited for residents who live there just simply because they have holidays. They have family members, they have gatherings and celebrations, and they need those spaces, and that makes sense. So there's no reasonable option for us to park elsewhere. We've only requested this brief temporary bagging of no parking signs once or twice annually. So it's not often, it's only for a few hours, and we'd be happy to accommodate the city in any way possible. If workload is an issue, for the community service officers, we'd be happy to go to City Hall, pick up the bags, and return them in a specified amount of time. Anything that would help. So in summary, the infrequent request to briefly bag the no parking signs has never been abused. It has not caused a safety issue to our knowledge or any accidents or traffic problems, and we'd be more than willing to help with a solution.
Thank you, Ms. Keller.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Mr. Wellna. Mayor.
Welcome.
Members of the council. My name is Jim Wellna. I live at 5139 West 44th Street, and I've lived there for 36 years. You have a copy of a letter that I shared last week with Mr. Nolan, the transportation planner. And at that meeting, which Liz was able to attend, this issue was brought up, and it was suggested at that meeting that this issue come back to the council. That's why we're here tonight. Feel a little bit bad because you have many, many important issues. And this is, of course, a minor one compared to some of the issues you're facing. But it's important to us. It's something that makes it more livable. It makes us able to use our homes, to have guests. And I don't think it's something that we've ever abused. And as Liz said, we're certainly willing to reduce the city load that might be involved in this and come and get the bags ourselves and return them in an appropriate way. So I would ask the council to discuss this and to review it and to allow exceptions to be made to this rule. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Wellna. Anyone else?
My name is Barbara Lavalure. I live at 7621 Edinburgh Way, Unit 2110 in Edina. Have done for over 13 years. And I hope that I'm able to give my comments about a resolution that's before the council. Am I able to do that?
Yeah, I'm sorry, you cannot.
I cannot.
No, it's not on the public hearing portion of the agenda.
Okay. Can I?
Pardon me.
Can I come stay for the public hearing and speak at that moment?
No, there isn't a public hearing on that, and anything that is on our agenda tonight cannot be commented on in community comment.
All right, thank you.
But if you have something in writing,
however, if you have your comment in writing, you could hand it to the clerk. You did email something today.
I did.
Both you and your husband emailed. So if you have a handout, you can hand it to the clerk, and she'll give it to us. It'll become part of the record.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. So I know Mr. Rogers is probably sitting there. Well, let's hear from this lady, and then we'll
have
a conversation about this little dilemma that seems on
good
the face
evening.
Of it like it's...
My name is Lisa Williams. I am the owner of Bespoke Hair Artisans at 3918 West 49th and a half Street. And I've owned Bespoke for about 6 years now. And I'm just here because I received the letter in regards to changing the street to Market Street. I just want to say...
Ms. Williams?
Yes.
Ms. Williams, that's going to be on a public hearing later this evening. So when that item comes up on the agenda, then you are welcome to come up and talk to
us
about it.
Okay,
so,
perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, that's fine. Happy to explain it. And for other folks who are wondering about items that were on the consent agenda, the council may pull certain items from the consent agenda for discussion by the council. But unless a matter is a public hearing matter and has been noticed up in advance, fundamental philosophy here is that it would be unfair to have what we would call a de facto public hearing on an issue that other people may have a different opinion on that somehow becomes a matter of comment on a particular evening where that item is on the agenda but not as a public hearing matter. So we've adopted this policy that unless it's a public hearing, we won't take public comment, but you can certainly stay and listen to the comment of the council if it is pulled from the consent agenda and discussed. So, anyone else or any comment? All right, we'll move on to the consent agenda. There are 12 items on the consent agenda. Is there anyone on the council that wishes to remove an item from the consent agenda? Hearing nothing?
No, Mr. Mayor.
Oh, excuse me, Member Fisher.
I would like to pull item, 5F. That's the...
5F is the resolution 2017-29, proposed resolution.
Yep.
All right. With the exception of 5F, is there a motion to approve the balance of the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
We got a motion and a second to approve the balance of the consent agenda with the exception of 5F. Any further discussion? All those in favor of approving the consent agenda with the exception of 5F say yes.
Aye.
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 Aye. Opposed say nay. Carried. 5F, Member Fisher.
Mr. Mayor, I obviously there are folks that are interested in this one, and while they can't speak to it, I think we could at least articulate why we would want to, you know, it's on the consent agenda, so if we approve the consent agenda, in effect, we're approving this resolution. I think it's worth at least giving some explanation as to why we might be inclined to do that.
Sure. Understood.
So I think, you know, we've gotten some good feedback from folks that are members of condo associations or have dealt with issues where it's been helpful to not be burdened and to be able to bring lawsuits or what have you. My reason for, first of all, the city's not changing the rule. What we'd be doing is passing a resolution that says we're supportive of better language to balance this issue. The reason I think it's a good idea, and I certainly wouldn't want to pass a resolution on something that I think is taking away the opportunity for homeowners to protect themselves, but there's been a lot of what I would call abuse of the system, and I would say it's sort of, my experience is through it's a predatory attorneys, essentially, that have used this, no offense to the fine attorneys that are in this room tonight. But there have been legitimate situations, and it's continuous, it's been continuous, where condo management companies are actually teamed up with attorneys, and it's absolute a matter of fact that on the ninth year, magically, there's a list of problems. There's a claim, the developer sued, the developer sues the contractor sues the subcontractors and the architect and the engineers. Everyone's sued, and ultimately they all settle, and there's a pot of money. And what this, and that's why, frankly, and I'll just say in my business, I'm in a design firm, we have a policy as of about 5 years ago, we won't touch, we're never gonna design a condo for that reason. And most other firms are in the same boat. Most contractors and developers are there. That's why we don't see condos being built. And so my understanding is the legislation is to try and put in some basic requirements that kind of makes it more a legitimate case that has to be made. And when I look at this, and I looked at it again when I got the correspondence over the last couple of days, and so, you know, am I missing something here? I don't feel like I am. I think the requirement that homeowners associations are, you know, that the members are all up to speed in pursuing that legal action and have a say, the disclosure, the requirement for mediation, all of those things can lead to a positive outcome if there's truly a problem for the homeowners, but it takes away this sort of predatory system that we've had in place. I think the reason, why does it matter for Edina? Why would we even take this on? Is that we've heard consistently from our residents, why are we just having apartments built in this town? Apartments, apartments, everywhere apartments. This is part of the reason. And so it's important for our city, as we have people that want to be in homeowner situations, but not in single family homes, we have to have the ability for, somebody's gotta stand up and wanna build these things again. And ultimately, we're gonna be relying on the legislature to get this right. And so the way I've been reading this is we're just simply saying this is important to get right. Here's some things that are important, and it's been sort of in the realm of what the legislation said so far. So that's why I have personally felt it was legitimate to move this forward. Now, is it going to matter what the city of Edina thinks or says? I don't know. You know, we're one of many cities and many entities that might have a resolution supporting or not supporting it. But I've felt to this point that it's what this language says is it balances the needs of the homeowners with the industry.
Thank you, Member Fisher. Member Staunton.
So I don't have the benefit of having Member Fisher's professional familiarity with the topic, and it comes to us without a cover memo, without any staff research. And to me, it feels like we're right in the middle of a very complex issue that's got people arguing on both sides of it. And I frankly don't feel capable of making a judgment about what's the right voice to speak with on the issue. And so I can't support it given the circumstances that are before us this evening.
Thank you. Member Stewart.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. When I saw this resolution, my immediate thought is that I don't like it when a city like ours weighs in on issues that are appropriately being considered by other governmental bodies, in this case the state legislature. So I tend to align with Member Staunton that when issues that I think are really more appropriately being considered by others who are deeply investigating them and that kind of thing. I just don't have a great comfort level in us weighing in on them. So my preference is that we just sit on the sidelines and let the state legislature do the work.
Thank you, Member Stewart. Member Brindle?
Thank you. I attended a meeting recently to learn more about this and heard from the couple of legislators who are working on this, on these two bills. And the, while there are some very technical aspects to this, the piece of it that really was compelling to me was that a lawsuit can be brought currently, today, by a majority of board members of a condo association. So the other condo owners may not even know that this is going on, that they are being entered into a lawsuit. And so I was very interested in finding out if how that works, and I've never owned a condo. And so I wanted to find out just how that works. I do know people who live in condos where the boards do take action independently, and it causes great difficulty for the residents. And that's really what perked my interest in this. So that's really why I come to this with a sympathetic ear, is that if this by supporting this, and if this legislation does get through, then it's not a majority of the board members that would initiate a lawsuit. It's the majority of the condo owners, I perked up and wanted to really listen to more about what this is about. But that was the underlying and compelling reason why I felt that this was important and worth standing behind.
Thank you,
Mr. Mayor. If I can just chime in, I just want to picking up on Member Stewart's comments. I just want to be clear that. It may well be that this is an issue of interest to our community, and one that we want to wade into and we want to learn about, and that there's a voice we can speak with. I just don't feel capable of speaking with that voice tonight. I'm not afraid to put our voice in with the state legislature and taking, you know, giving guidance or giving our opinion as to what the right direction is to go. I just feel like we have a lack of information to make that, or I have a lack of information to make that decision with this evening. Thank you.
Member Fisher.
Can I ask the city attorney a question? This didn't actually occur to me till I was talking just a minute ago. Do I have a conflict in this? Just the fact that, you know, I'm sitting there talking about that my company used to design condos before we made it a policy not to. Could that be seen as a, that somehow I'm using this really odd avenue to get something done at the legislature?
Mayor, members of the council. The answer is no, I don't think it's a legal conflict. Okay. You have an interest in the subject, and it could affect anyone, whether you own a condo or might own a condo, or whether you could be sued, or so no, I don't think it's a conflict.
Thanks.
Thank you. This whole conversation over condominium housing, multifamily housing that's owned, started at the Regional Council of Mayors over a year ago, because all the not all, but many of the mayors in the metropolitan area were wondering, and there are anywhere from 20 to 40 of us that meet on a monthly basis, we were wondering why we hadn't seen any condominium development over the past decade. And in Edina, we haven't had a condominium project built for over 10 years. And so we brought in speakers on the topic to tell us what the challenges were with respect to condominium development, and we learned that there were only two entities in the metropolitan area building condominiums. This despite a rather significant market demand, particularly in Edina that I'm aware of, because we live here and work here and represent people here. When I spoke several months ago now to the Edina realtors about the state of affairs in the city of Edina, they were wondering where are the condominiums? Because every day they get calls about people that want to buy a condominium, but nobody dares to build a condominium. And so what was the reason why people that are in the development world and the construction world and the design world don't want to be engaged in condominium construction? We got an education on that, and Member Fisher has talked a little bit about that. So the downtown council for the city of Minneapolis put to work some attorneys that looked at the world of condominium law compared with the world of single-family ownership and other types of ownership. And here's the legislation in its current form, and I will tell you that I have been over there to testify in favor of it, along with three other mayors from Cottage Grove, Chanhassen, and Bloomington. And here's why I chose to testify in favor of this bill. Because, of course, the challenge is, how do you make sure that you protect your interests of your residents that live in a condominium project, and also balance that against the fact that you're missing a vital component of housing in your community because of a certain level of activity that's gone on in the legal world. So here's what's not changing. I mean, if you're in a condominium association and you're in a new development, you've got 10 years from the, to bring a cause of action. That's not changing in the proposed legislation. You still got that 10-year statute of limitations, that 10-year statute of repose, to bring a cause of action for a construction defect. That was really important to me to understand that nobody's rights had changed with respect to how long they had to bring a cause of action for a defect that was discovered in a condominium project. What has changed is, Member Brindle alluded to one of the issues, is that what's proposed is that no longer can the board of directors of the condominium association make the determination as to whether or not they want to start a lawsuit. It's got to be determined by a majority of the owners of the association. If they make that determination, the next step before litigation is there's mandatory mediation. You try to get together with the developer, the contractor, whoever it is that you think caused the problems, and you try to mediate a settlement. If you don't get there, then you have to, you can go to litigation. You can still go to litigation and sue. The one significant thing that I think has changed relative to litigation is that attorney's fees aren't awarded anymore automatically to, let's say, the winning party. So everybody pays their own attorney's fees as a notion now. And that was a factor in what was going on over the past 10 years, according to the experts that we talked in the field. So contractors won't build them, developers won't develop them, architects won't design them, financing people won't provide the financing, and it's created a gap in our housing choices that I think, on balance, it was important to address. And that's why I support this resolution. So whether we support it as a council or not, I think the heavy lifting will be at the legislature. But I think that those that have worked on this diligently, including those folks led by the downtown council in Minneapolis, have got their feet underneath them pretty well. The law is balanced up now. So when they looked at the rights of single family homeowners, the rights of condominium owners would now be balanced with homeowners. And there's a few other issues as well that I think are important. The requirement for complete disclosure to homeowners association members regarding the alleged defects, so when they go to decide if they're going to vote in favor of litigation, they have a complete understanding of it. And then also a requirement that homeowners associations adopt and implement a preventative maintenance plan. Well, everybody should do that anyway. You know, you'd expect that. You do it in your household, and they do it at a condominium association. So I support this resolution. Unlike Member Stoughton, I feel like, having been over there and testified on it and been backgrounded in it, I feel pretty comfortable supporting the resolution. So we can certainly have more discussion, or we can vote.
I would just like to add one element that there were some studies done and looked at with regard to a number of these lawsuits, and on average the management companies that were helping manage these condo associations, the condos, when we talk about the proper maintenance, this is really a big deal to actually put the proper amount of money into maintenance every year, just like we would hope to do in our own homes. But on the whole, in these associations, they were maybe a quarter of what they should have been budgeting. So it's not to say that that was always the case. I mean, there are legitimate cases where there's something bad that happened. But I really think that this balances that and takes away, hopefully, the frivolous lawsuits that are stopping this stuff from being built.
All right. Any further discussion? Otherwise, I'll entertain a motion to adopt resolution 2017-29.
So moved.
Second.
Second. We've got a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
Carried. We are now going to move on to the special recognitions and presentations portion of the agenda, and we are privileged this evening to have our county attorney with us, Mr. Mike Freeman. We had him at Rotary a few weeks ago. He did a terrific job bringing all the Rotarians up to speed on what's happening in the world of law enforcement, and we welcome you here this evening.
Mr. Mayor,
thank you for coming out to Edina.
Mr. Mayor and members of the council, thank you, and I appreciated having an opportunity to hear democracy at work. Having started my career at the Richfield Housing Redevelopment Authority, it brings some pleasant memories back, pleasant memories and long evenings, as I recall. I'm here because I want to talk and share a couple thoughts about the issue of crime here in Edina and throughout Hennepin County, and to make a couple suggestions. But I would be remiss if I didn't first thank you and the Edina Police Force for a job well done. The chief's a fine chief, but you wouldn't have good police officers if you, council members and Mr. Mayor, didn't have the courage to pay them the salary they deserve. When you look at the police salaries in Hennepin County and in the suburban areas, they're really quite good. They're not as much as perhaps they'd like, but they are enough so we have high quality officers. And many places in this country simply don't have quality officers because we don't pay them well. And the chief probably would like me to say they'd like a little bump, but I think you do very well. And we know the police have a difficult job. You know, I'll remind you of the incident in June 2016, and a Edina officer was assaulted and injured after a traffic stop. It appeared to be a fairly routine traffic stop, but traffic stops rarely are. And after assisting the individual, he hit the officer a number of times. Well, we charged and convicted Mr. Rotenberg of third-degree assault, which he deserved. And we will back up your police officers when they're doing their job and with the appropriate criminal penalties. Crime in Edina is always very interesting. It goes up a little, it goes down a little bit. It doesn't move very fast. I looked at some numbers in my preparation to come here tonight, and what I thought was the most interesting was in the years comparing 2014 and 15, at the same time that robbery went from 10 to 3, aggravated assault went from 6 to 12. Sounds like a wash to me. And although the crimes may be seen to be a little different, it has been fairly consistent. But on the most serious crime, in the last 6 years, we've charged one murder here in Edina. You're to be commended for that. And I think the reason the crime is so low here, there's a number of reasons, but the cooperation between the police, the council, and the citizens are impressive. The cops can't do their job if the citizens don't cooperate, and we can't bring successful prosecutions unless the police officers bring us good cases. I think we're able to do that collectively, and I'm proud of that, and I'd like to think we do a little part of that because our prosecution rate of the cases we charge is 92%. I think that's about right. If it was a whole lot better than that, we probably aren't charging some cases we should, and if it was a lot lower than that, we're probably charging some cases we shouldn't. Now, we make mistakes like everyone else, and yesterday in the paper and tomorrow morning you'll see a story about whether our office made a mistake. We try to rectify those as soon as we can, and the person we charged that we shouldn't have and the evidence fell apart, we dismissed. That's our job, and we stand up and try to do that. Another good omen in the criminal justice world is the stabilizing of the prison population. Unfortunately, Minnesota, like many places across the country, the prison population has been steadily upward over the last 15 years. It is now flat, and we anticipate it going down. One of the reasons is a change in the legislature of some of the drug sentences, something that I've been advocating for 7 years. What we've done is to reduce the penalties for drug users and abusers, the addicts, if you will, and actually enhance them for some of the dealers. You know, we can work with an addict, we can provide treatment. And that's what we do for addicts. But for the people who make their living, I don't know a good anecdote for greed other than giving them a long-term lease in the big house. And that's why we try to draw the line. We're trying to enhance drug courts to help the addicts. We're working on veterans court, which reaches in and tries to make sure our veterans, who are committing often very minor crimes, but continually are doing that because of lack of services they needed to receive for issues that occurred when they were in the service. Our mental health court is the same. Our specialty courts are as good as anywhere in the country, and I think that helps a lot. I spent a lot of time trying to keep kids out of trouble. Now, looking particularly at the males and city council, and I see the manager smiling at me, I imagine little Scotty had a little trouble when he was a kid. I know little Mikey Freeman did, and Minneapolis's finest did the worst thing they could possibly do to that. They called Orville Freeman, former Marine Corps colonel, and my father to come pick me up. That was the ugliest situation in my life. Never touched me, didn't have to. I learned my lesson that way. That's what I call cop and parental diversion. Let's not put my name in the criminal justice system. Let's keep it out of it, but let's make sure I don't do it again. We have police diversion, and your Edina cops are good at that. We have county attorney diversion. We see the case come in, but before we even file it in court, we divert them into some kind of program that helps them understand what they did is wrong, has some community service, and has them write an essay about what they've learned. We've kept a record off of a lot of kids. And that's one of the reasons that our number of cases in juvenile court is about 40% of what it was 5 or 6 years ago. The number of people in the juvenile justice center is way down. We need to have the room and the capacity to deal with kids who make major errors, but let's try to keep them out wherever we can, because I don't want a juvenile mistake to haunt them the rest of our lives. When I was a boy, the records in juvenile court were kept on 3x5 cards. You would say, Freeman, how do you know that piece of trivia? Well, for the last 10 years of his working life, my grandfather was very proud to be clerk of juvenile court in Hennepin County. He had a roll-top desk and a three-piece suit, and he sat there every day and kept track of everyone who had it. We obviously are much more sophisticated today, and that can be a problem because the data miners will find out about kids and can make a difference in their life. We've worked hard on diversion programs for kids, as I said, our curfew program. We have now decriminalized that, and so kids are referred to the Project Link, and they work with the family. You know, why is a kid out at 2 o'clock in the morning? You know, it's not usually because the parents are watching, or maybe the problem is the parents, or maybe at the home situation. But most kids out after 2 o'clock in the morning are either going to have something done to them, or they're going to do something to other people, neither which is good. So let's get to the bottom of that. But again, only in the most severe cases should that be a part of the criminal justice system. Let me conclude with two things that I think we're learning some lessons on and we're doing better. And you face those issues as well. It's called accountability and transparency. Your meeting tonight, allowing people to come and watch and to participate, is the kind of transparency you have. And the fact that you face the voters, just like I do every 4 years, is part of our accountability. But sometimes in the most serious cases, we were doing neither. Those are the cases in which police officers used deadly force and killed a civilian. Those cases have traditionally always gone to the grand jury, and the decision of the grand jury decides not to charge is a no bill, and nothing is shared. Well, that doesn't work. And in the Jamar Clark tragedy, I decided not to use a grand jury. I decided to make that decision myself, which I did. And so if people disagree with that decision, they can visit me at the ballot box next November. But to make sure people understood, my speech when I announced my reasons and rationale and the law why I didn't charge went on my website. A 64-page analysis annotated to each police report expressed the facts. We put all the police reports, all the forensic, all the DNA, everything, including the videos, on our website at the same time I announced the decision. And almost immediately, we had 80,000 people visited our website within a week, and there were 360,000 views of the video. Minnesotans had a chance to understand what we did. Now, there are still people who disagree, but there is no question about the facts that were there, and modern technology allowed us to do that. So in conclusion, crime's always going to be a problem, members. I think this community does a good job of it. This community, like all others, learns from different episodes and things they do, and I'm proud that this police force and this council stepped up, learned some things, and acknowledged that. That's why we're elected officials. That's why we serve. And, Mr. Mayor, I'm probably exceeding my time limit, but if there's one or two questions, I'd be glad to answer.
You have not exceeded your time limit, and there may be some questions. Are there? I've got one, Mr. Mayor. Member Brindle, go ahead. All right. So you had mentioned the mental health court, and it caused me to think about the situation we had here in our community, and I just wanted to compliment your folks that are employed by the county that work in that mental health court system. This young guy got handled, his case was handled with great care and careful analysis, I think, in terms of what the challenges were that he was facing from a mental health standpoint. But when I've heard the sheriff talk about his responsibilities down at the county, he talks about some of the folks that he has in the county jail that really maybe shouldn't be there, that they've got these mental health issues. And I just wonder, from based on your experience, are we handling everything in the right way when it comes to people with mental health challenges? You know, is there a better way to deal with them than to put them in lockup for and then run them through I think the mental health court system part of it is a good thing, but I'm wondering about the other incarceration part of it. Should we be doing something different as Minnesotans? Because we're always trying to make sure that we treat people the right way.
Mr. Mayor, that's a great question, but there are really two parts. One, we think we have in Minnesota a pretty good system of people who are mentally ill or subject to chemical issues who are of a danger to themselves or others. And our mental commitment process recognizes that if we order treatment, we're taking that person's liberty away. That's a major thing. You know, most of us are immigrants, and most of us came to this country to be free. And to take a person's liberty away unless they've committed a crime is a serious matter. So we have a clear and convincing evidence standard, which is halfway between preponderance of evidence, the civil, or beyond a reasonable doubt of the criminal. And I think we do a great job, and thank you, Mr. Mayor, because we got some great, great folks who work there and judges who do that. The second question is, why do so many people with mental health issues end up in our jail? Well, frankly, because it's the only place available to take folks. Someone was found wandering the streets, delirious, not well. There's really no place. And there's been some discussions about having kind of halfway houses or the old detox, if you will, Mr. Mayor, and you remember that. Having a place you can take the people short of jail. I think that would be a good idea. And I know the county board's talking about it. But the largest psychiatric hospital in the world is the Cook County jails. And Sheriff Stanek has estimated that over 40% of the people in his jail at any time have mental illness problems. We need to do a lot of things about that. Having a different kind of facility is something. Expediting those cases. If their issue is not their criminality, or their criminality is a subpart of their mental illness, let's move them quickly, and they're not going to get better in a jail that simply cannot provide the services people need. I think people recognize that and are doing something. I guess I need to make one more point because I don't want to mislead anyone. This state, I believe, has gone too far in the re-incarceration of individuals who have sexual psychopathic issues. Our present program is unattainable, or is not acceptable is a better word, and many people have been trying to do something about it, including our governor. There's a lot of opposition in the legislature to coming up with anything that would allow people who have been incarcerated for their crime, kept in commitment at St. Peter or Moose Lake for a long time, and now, you know, should have aged out, they're 65 or 70, they should get out, and it's very hard because there's very few places for them to get out and pretty bad procedures to do that. And against the desire of some folks, I supported some efforts in the federal court to at least evaluate these people every other year, at least evaluate them and give them an opportunity to show that they have cured the issue they have, or they've aged out, because some people do. And finally, we just have to have more alcoholic treatment and mental illness in our prisons. You say, well, why should they have the luxury of going through these programs? 60% of the crime that's committed in this county is committed when people are high or drunk, 60%. Now, that is really a stunning number when you think about it. And some of those people have chronic problems. And wouldn't it be better to help provide treatment either before they're ever incarcerated or while they're incarcerated and before they get out to help with that? I think it is. But having had a wonderful opportunity to spend 8 years in the Minnesota Senate, there's only so many dollars in the Senate, too, and that's not one of the most popular issues to work on.
Thank you. Mr. Freeman, and just on a personal note, I feel fortunate that in the criminal justice system, we've had two people that have, I think, done a remarkable job for the citizens of Minnesota, and that's you at the Hennepin County Attorney's Office and Andy Luger at the U.S. Yes. Attorney's Office, and I hate to see him go. I know that's a political appointment, but the two of you personify quintessential professionalism in my mind in representing the people in the criminal justice system on the prosecutorial side.
Mr. Mayor, thank you for your kind comments about me, and I join you about former United States Attorney Andy Luger. He's a friend of mine. And by the way, you know, you all are political folks too. You may recall that there was an election in 2006 when both Mr. Luger and I wanted to be county attorney. I was lucky to win, and he lost. We've become close friends since then. He was a great, great United States attorney, and I kind of loved the Star Tribune about 2 weeks ago saying, come on, Attorney General Sessions, let's get your stuff together and reappoint Andy Luger. I agree. Thank you very much for
having
me.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Freeman. In the special recognitions and presentations portion of the agenda, the next matter is the proclamation for Arbor Day. And I will read that proclamation, and Arbor Day being designated as April 28, 2017. Whereas in 1872, J. Sterling Morton proposed to the Nebraska Board of Agriculture that a special day be set aside for the planting of trees. And this holiday, called Arbor Day, was first observed at the planting of more than a million trees in Nebraska. I know you might find that hard to believe. They hardly made a dent, I know. And whereas 2017 is the 145th anniversary of the holiday, and Arbor Day is now observed throughout the nation and the world. And whereas trees and forests improve our physical health by cleaning the air, reducing exposure to the sun's UV rays, and decreasing temperatures during the summertime, and whereas one tree provides $62,000 worth of pollution control over a period of 50 years. And whereas trees can reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, cut heating and cooling costs, moderate the temperature, clean the air, produce life-giving oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife. And whereas forests create high-quality drinking water by acting as a natural filter. And whereas Edina is proud of the beautiful shade trees which grace our homes and public places. And now, therefore, I, James B. Hovland, Mayor of Edina, do hereby proclaim April 28, 2017, be Arbor Day and call upon the spirited and foresighted citizens of Edina to plant trees now for our pleasure and the pleasure of future generations. And we have, first of all, let's adopt a proclamation. It should have actually come from the council, not from me, I think. Is there a motion to adopt a proclamation?
So moved.
Second.
All right. I was thinking the guy with the daughter at the University of Nebraska would be participating in that motion, but that's okay. Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say nay. Carried. And Luther Overholt is here to our forester to accept the proclamation. I think Miss Tim has it in her packet, or else your packet's upstairs, is it? Oh, okay.
That's okay.
Mr. Overholt, you want your comments on Arbor Day and things that are happening in Edina from a forestry standpoint would be helpful.
I'd like to thank you for the proclamation and give you a little info about our Arbor Day celebration this year. Kind of ramping up now for Emerald Ash Borer. It's not here in Edina yet, but it is next door in Minneapolis, Richfield, and Bloomington. And so this year, we're doing our celebration at Sherwood Park, where I've removed preemptively four ash trees that are on the boulevard just in preparation for Emerald Ash Borer. We kind of removed every other tree, so we'll be going back in there and planting four new 20-gallon, trees where we took out the old ones, so that once Emerald Ash Borer does come, hopefully these trees will be a little more mature and established, as opposed to starting all at the same time with small little trees. And so I'd like to invite everyone to the celebration. It's April 28th at 10 a.m. at Sherwood Park, and we'll be there planting and celebrating Arbor Day.
Okay. Good. Thank you, Mr. Overholt.
Thanks.
Before we go to the final item on special recognitions and presentations, which is speak of Edina. No, excuse me, we got two more matters. Before we go to Mr. Nolan, I wanted to just recognize we got quite a few students in the audience this evening. What school are you all from?
Valley View.
All from Valley View?
Yep.
All right, great. Well, nice to have you here this evening. You picked an interesting evening to come. You've heard some really fascinating arguments on a variety of topics, I think, or comments too. So it's good. Welcome, all of you. Welcome. All right, on to Mark Nolan, who is going to give us an update on the 2016 Pedestrian and Cyclist Safety Fund activity. Mr. Nolan, welcome.
Good evening, Mayor, members of council. I'm not sure how interesting this is going to be for middle school students, but it's been a while since I've had a chance to stand in front of you, so I appreciate the opportunity to do that. And I'm here tonight to speak to you about the 2016 Pedestrian and Cyclist Safety Fund, how that fund was spent, and just a brief summary about that. Just a quick agenda. This is, I believe, the second or third year that I've done this with council. And what I'd like to do, in addition to talking about last year, is comparing it to previous years as well. So I've got a brief slide to talk about that, to see how we've spent those funds over the past few years. Kept that pretty pictures, so I was able to get out today on a sunny day and take some photographs of some of our projects, and then talk about some of our proposed projects, tax-funded projects for this year and for next year. So I always like to start off with a brief review about the PACS fund. It was approved by council in December of 2012. The revenue is generated by utility franchise fees from both Xcel Energy and CenterPoint Energy customers. Generates about $1.2 million annually. It started at 1.1. It's creeping up a little bit. And is, of course, used in addition to paying for one staff person exclusively for improvements to the city's non-motorized transportation network. That includes construction, maintenance, and then some other associated costs like consultant fees and the like. And there is a stated bias in the early years of the fund for or towards construction as opposed to maintenance, and that's certainly the case for 2016. So this chart that you see is lifted right from the report, and we rolled over from 2015, that should say 2016 PACS fund on the top, not 15. We rolled over $700,000 from 2015 to 2016. And so that's why that number, $1.92 million, basically so much higher than the $1.2 million that I talked about earlier in terms of revenue. And we did a pretty decent job of spending that money this past year. We spent basically $1.9 million of the PACS fund last year, and 94% of that was on construction, which is higher. That's the highest that we've had of any of the past few years. And so what we're looking at now is rolling over a much smaller number into 2017. I'll talk about that in a minute. So 93.8% spent on construction, nearly 89% of that spent on sidewalks and bike facilities, and really the vast majority of that is sidewalks. I've talked to you before about how sidewalks really, construction of sidewalks accounts for the majority of the fund. It's much more expensive than some of the other things that we do. But essentially, we have spent 89% of that fund on sidewalks. And you note that sidewalk construction here, we're going to go to the next slide. So this slide, again, summarizes how the fund was spent over the past few years. We've got a couple of years under our belt now. We can actually take a look and see what's been done over these past few years. And so the green line is that the available funds for the PACS fund. Again, starting off higher than that black line, which is the revenue. That's remained steady, slightly increasing over the past few years. That green line is higher because of the rollover. The red line is the funds that were spent for each year. So you can see that that line has gone up to the point where this past year we basically spent all of the available funds. And what that means, in order to set expectations, is looking at next year, is that we are essentially resetting back to where we were in 2015. Next year we will have funds available that are gathered by that revenue that we get from those franchise fees. And so what the story I wanna tell here is kinda highlighted by those by the sidewalk construction. So if you look on the along that red line, I've kinda annotated how much sidewalk is constructed over the past few years. And so from 2014 to 2015, we nearly doubled the length of sidewalk that was constructed over that period of time. And then from 15 to 16, you'll see that we spent nearly $750,000 more, but only increased sidewalk construction by about a tenth of a mile. And that's primarily because we've had a couple of sidewalk projects that were very expensive that I'll show you some images of. We built sidewalk on Xerxes Avenue from 56th and 60th Street, and also Interlochen Boulevard. We finished off that sidewalk project. And those two projects are 2 and 3 times, respectively, the cost of our average sidewalk project per lineal foot. Very expensive, a lot of topography, et cetera. And we're also dealing with rising bid prices. It's costing more to do construction these days. So that's partially explains why we spent so much more money and didn't get as much in terms of sidewalk projects. And what I want to talk about too is that looking into next year, because we're looking at a 30 or 40% decrease in funds, we really are projecting a 30 or 40% decrease in the amount of sidewalk that we're able to construct for next year. So just kind of a way to set some expectations. So I just run through quickly some of our sidewalk projects that we constructed, not just sidewalk, but other projects over the past year. We have the sidewalk in the Gulf Terrace B neighborhood sidewalk, Xerxes Avenue South sidewalk. That's a sidewalk that I discussed earlier that it's been needed for quite a long time. We're happy to get that in the ground, but it did cost some money to do so. Strakauer Park A, another neighborhood sidewalk project that we constructed. This picture is along Strakauer Park itself. We also built Cornelia Drive sidewalk. That's the bottom image. That sidewalk is an active routes to school sidewalk and was included $209,000 in federal funding for that project. Interlochen Boulevard, the image on the top, that was a project that was started in 2015, but due to cost considerations, we spread out over 2 years. And that image kind of demonstrates some of the reasons why that project was so expensive. We actually had to engineer those retaining walls in order to get that sidewalk in. But I know there's not a time I don't drive by that sidewalk where someone's not using it. We also have some crossing projects that were crossing improvement projects that were put in. This one here on the bottom is at Gleason and Indian Hills Pass. That is near Creek Valley School. Some of the pedestrian improvements that are associated with the new roundabout at Tracy Valley View and Valley View Lane, making those connections to the Nine Mile Creek Regional Trail crossing. Another crossing improvement along 77th Street and Park Lawn. That's actually a location where pedestrians were prohibited from crossing, even though we had bus stops on either side of the street. So we got some input from a resident, actually, and pursued that and built a crossing and gave some access to some of our transit riders at that location. Vernon Avenue sidewalk from Blake to Gleason, that image on the top. That sidewalk was partially funded by the county. And then we did stripe some bike lanes just north of our public works facility at 72nd Street and Ohms, which also connects to the Nine Mile Creek Regional Trail. Quickly to run through some of the projects that we're looking to construct this year, we have sidewalks associated with the Birchcrest A, Countryside B, and G neighborhood projects. And part of those projects together includes a sidewalk along Valley View Road that is over a mile long that starts at Highway 100 and extends all the way to Tracy Avenue as part of that project. There's more than a mile of sidewalks just on that one street. The Oaklawn Avenue sidewalk just south of Cornelia School is also an active routes to school sidewalk. We're looking to put that in this year. And then we have some various sidewalk segments, and some of these projects we're lucky enough that they may be able to be constructed by public works crews. We do have a concrete crew here in Edina, and because some of these sidewalk projects are shorter, some of these crossing projects are able to be done by our crews, which saves the fund an awful lot of money. So we've got some sidewalk segments on Park Long associated with our state aid projects, and a couple hundred feet of sidewalk on Industrial Boulevard and Vernon Avenue, both near Highway 100. Additionally, we have some pedestrian crossing improvements that we're working on this year. A couple near schools. On Doncaster Way at the entrance to Highland School, we're going to improve that pedestrian crossing at that location. Same goes in front of the high school on Valley View Road. We have a crosswalk that exists there right now. We're going to be moving that crosswalk to the west to align more with the entrance of that school, and we've been working with the school district on that. And then just to the east of us at 50th Street and Eden Avenue, we're going to be replacing those worn-out crosswalks with new crosswalks and a rectangular rapid flashing beacon crossing along 50th Street at that location. Another crossing near the Cub Foods on Xerxes, and we're going to be making connections to the Nine Mile Creek Regional Trail where the bridge across 100 lands on the east side and the north part of the trail. We're going to make a connection from our street grid to that location. Another connection we're making is at the new roundabout along Valley View Road to the Courtney Fields Trail Complex. We're able to reuse a bridge that's being removed from Braemar and pull that over and put that in place to be able to make a connection from the sidewalks on that roundabout to that trail complex. And then also some fees will be used for some funds for the pedestrian and bicycle master plan that's coming up this year. Some of the 2018 projects that we're looking at, these are obviously dependent upon where our bids come in, what projects we're able to get to this year, so maybe perhaps not all of these projects will be constructed, but we're sure doing what we can to make that happen. Bredesen Park E neighborhood sidewalks and Concord G neighborhood sidewalks, those are projects associated with neighborhood reconstruction projects. We're looking to construct a sidewalk on West 62nd Street between Valley View Road and France Avenue. That is a state aid project, so state funds would pay for 80% of those sidewalks, with the PACS fund contributing 20%. We are also looking at a sidewalk on 58th Street between Wooddale and France Avenue. That's another active routes to school sidewalk. We've been meeting with residents on that project, and there's a lot of support for that project, so we're hoping, we're looking at the design of that right now. And a project that's been, I believe, in front of council here, the Valley View Road sidewalk from Mark Terrace Drive to Gleason Road. That, again, is a project where we received a petition from residents, and again, that is one of those projects that we're anticipating being fairly expensive, so if we can't construct it all in 1 year, we can look at constructing it over a more than 1 year period. And we're working with this City of St. Louis Park to fill the sidewalk gap on France Avenue between 39th Street and 42nd Street on the west side, and we have applied for Hennepin County funds for that project. And then we're also looking to do some crossing and signal improvements on Vernon Avenue in the Grandview District. These are recommendations that came out of the Grandview project, the transportation study that we finished up recently. Those are improvements at Interlochen, the entrance to Jerry's, and then also Link Road. And that's what I have tonight. I can take questions if you have any.
Yeah, it's always a wonderful update, I think, as we build out our sidewalk system. For the students in the audience, you might explain. Back at the very beginning, you talked about the source of funds being the two utilities and how their own homes help pay for the sidewalk construction and what that modest amount of money is per month.
Right. And so those franchise fees basically amount to $1.45 each for your electric bill and your gas bill. So $2.90 for each single family residence. Those numbers go up for businesses, but that number alone amounts to $1.2 million a year that we can use for these projects.
Good. Questions for Mr. Nolan? Comments?
Oh.
Director Milner.
Well, I just wanted to share how much of a benefit this fund is. In the last year, Mark was able to write grant applications to secure $350,000 of grants to build sidewalks. So just having that matching funds available in order to even go out for those grants is such a huge benefit with using this fund. So I just wanted to share that with the council that Mark's one of our best grant writers in town, and he's doing a real good job at it.
Good. Thank you, Director Mulder. And Manager Neal.
Yeah, and I would just expand on that a little bit. I think for those of you that were on the council at the time when we initiated this new program, there was some discussion about, gee, do we need a headcount? Do we need to spend some of this money on a staffing function? And I think that this presentation, along with the
presentations that we get every year about this time, I think really demonstrate the value of having a person who coordinates this program for us, because we have probably the most aggressive sidewalk construction program, certainly of any city in the Twin Cities. We spend a lot more money on this than a lot of other cities do, and we aren't requiring private matches or special assessments for sidewalks. It's made a huge difference, but the idea that we go about this in a methodical, organized way, that we have shovel-ready projects, that we have someone like Mr. Nolan who knows where other people who've got little pots of money that we can dip into and when is the right time to go get that, is really important. It's allowed us to leverage more money into a program that's already pretty aggressive. So, very happy with it, and Mr. Nolan's gets a lot of the credit for doing that.
Thanks, Manager Neal. Member Fisher.
Chad, thanks for answering the grant question. It's going to be my question for you is, how much money have we leveraged outside of this? And it's 300 and some thousand is what I heard. So to me, the way I look at this is, we're not necessarily paying for the salary. The salary is being earned through all the other matching funds, and I think it's just a great program.
Good. Thank you. Other comments? Member Brindle.
Just a quick one. Looking forward to active routes to school projects, how far into the future are we planned with sidewalks that are in the school walk shed?
We have included in the, when we went back and amended the comprehensive plan and redid that sidewalk plan, we had the sidewalks that were recommended in our active routes to school plan elevated in terms of priority, for lack of a better term, in our sidewalk system. And so our sidewalk plan goes out 20 years. However, we do prioritize, when those opportunities arise,
okay,
active routes to school sidewalks.
All right. I'm thinking about Highlands.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's a lot of traffic there. So.
And I would anticipate, because we are updating, essentially reworking our pedestrian and bicycle master plan this year. So
okay,
those types of that type of input that we hope to get could have an effect on what recommendations come out of that plan.
Great. Would you suggest that a resident petition be generated, or what kind of input would you like?
Well, petition is the most direct way because it goes right to council.
Okay.
They can certainly contact me, and I can work with them on that.
All right. Great. Perfect. Thank you.
Mr. Nolan, I think we're all grateful you decided to come back to the Midwest. You've done a wonderful job in our community. So thank you for the good work that you're doing.
Thank you.
And the next and final portion of the special recognitions and presentations portion of the agenda is Kaylin Eidsness with the monthly Speak Up Edina report. And this was regarding the proposed redevelopment at 49 and a half Street, which is part of the 50th and France District. Ms. Eidsness, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, Mayor, members of the City Council. Tonight, my Speak Up presentation is on the 49 and a half Street mixed-use redevelopment, as Mayor Hovland just spoke about. Speak Up Edina, for those who don't know, is our citizen engagement site. We have a monthly discussion, and that's what I'll be talking about tonight. So just a little background. The city owns several parcels of land near 50th and France. And after issuing a request for proposals to add public parking, commercial space, and a vibrant streetscape, the Buell Investors Saturday Property Development Team was selected as the preferred development partner. Their concept consists of two district components that would be constructed separately. Phase one involves expanding and remodeling the existing north ramp to include more public parking and new commercial space on the street level. And phase two includes replacing the aging center ramp with new commercial space and apartments centered around a new public plaza. Two levels of parking for residents and the general public would be below ground. So with that said, some questions we asked: how can the first phase of the north side of the street be improved or enhanced to better meet the needs of the community? How can the second phase be improved or enhanced? What is needed to ensure this project's success? What in the proposed public plaza would draw you to the area more frequently? And do you have other suggestions for the overall project? The discussion was open February 3rd through March 3rd. There were 53 comments made in total on Speak Up Edina and through Nextdoor. We promote the discussion through Nextdoor. We also promote it on Facebook and Twitter, along with the press release we send out. It's in our monthly newsletter edition, Edina and the Sun Current. But these comments were made on Nextdoor and on Speak Up Edina. We had 833 new visitors this month, with 911 total visitors, and there were 33, roughly 100 page views. So some common themes that I pulled out through the comments that we got, and the most prominent I felt was keep the small town feeling. Residents love the 50th and France area. They love the shops, the local businesses, and how it's a neighborhood corner. It's surrounded by residential, and they really like that kind of feeling. And they'd like us to keep that. Some people made comments about not having it be a West End or a commercial district that's just suddenly built up really fast like that, but keep that 50th and France just kind of small town feeling. They wanted, this was another big theme, be very considerate of traffic volumes, noise, and general congestion of the area. Parking was a big one, but general, they didn't want to have too much too fast that would hurt the congestion or the area and add general congestion. Make walkability and bike accessibility a priority and not an afterthought. So when putting this project together, make that a integral part of it. Being mindful of the building heights. Ensure there are a lot of green areas, so some suggestions, a lot of flowers, trees, shrubbery. Just keep in mind that this is the Edina Art Fair, and that's a huge tourist attraction to Edina, and that happens there, so that was something to keep in mind when going along with this project. I thought that was interesting. Add outdoor dining spaces. There were people who were really complimentary of the outdoor dining spaces at 50th and France, and they thought make that a big part of this project to add more to the street kind of style of the area. Ensure ample parking, like I said earlier, between traffic volumes and parking. There were a lot of comments on those two things to make sure that there would still be enough parking for everyone. And then just a couple other ideas, maybe a small farmer's market, and make sure to make it pet friendly. So that was the 49 and a half street discussion. And right now going on is our technology in public places. We're asking about Wi-Fi in parks, or having phone chargers, or what kind of other equipment maybe organizations expect in our meeting rooms. You guys have any questions?
Questions for Kaylin? Yeah. Interesting. We had a work session on the proposed potential project. I guess it's a little bit redundant, but we did have a conversation upstairs. So it's good to get this supplemental information from people that have a real interest in what happens down there in that jewel of a downtown of ours. So
yeah, it is.
Something we need to be very careful about. So thanks for gathering all that good information. Yeah. It was a great topic.
Thank you.
All right.
Have a good night.
Thanks. All right, we're going to move on now to the public hearing portion of the agenda. We've got two public hearing matters this evening, and the first one Director Teague has, and that is a proposed final approval on a project on the old Best Buy site at 66th and York, or Xerxes, York.
Yes, thank you, Mayor, members of the council. Project that you're all familiar with, the old Best Buy site on the the southeast corner, consists of three properties.
I was accurate saying both, Xerxes and
yes,
York.
Yes, yeah. You were. Exactly. So there was a single family home on Xerxes back here, a property that gained access off of Xerxes as well, but on 66th, and then the property on Southdale Circle. So these are three distinctly different lots that were part of three different plats. So to simplify the legal descriptions of the property, the applicant is simply combining those three lots together and doing so with a new plat. So it would be known as the Lot 1, Block 1 of the Doran KM2 Southdale First Edition. there's no changes proposed to the plans that were approved by the council early this past winter. Just quick renderings of those plans that, again, have all been approved by the city council. So we're just simply combining those three lots together to make one lot for the plat that will accommodate the development that's anticipated to begin construction this summer. The Planning Commission reviewed that plat and unanimously recommended approval. So with that, I can stand for any questions that you might have.
Questions for Director Teague. Member Brindle?
So just confirming that the approval that was previously granted does not change. This is simply the combination of three lots into one piece of property.
That is correct.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions for Director Teague from the council at this point in time? All right. This is a public hearing matter, as I mentioned earlier. If there's anyone in the audience that wishes to come forward and testify or inquire of the council, feel free to do so. You'll have 3 minutes to make your comments. Seeing no one coming forward, hearing nothing, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We had a motion and a second to close the public hearing. Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say nay. Carried. Do we have a motion?
I will move resolution number 2017-30.
Second.
All right, we've got a motion and a second to adopt resolution 2017-30, which is the preliminary and final plat approval. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say nay. Carried. Next public hearing matter, Manager Neal has, and this is a possibility of a name change on 49 and a half street to another name, one that has historic significance, Market Street. Manager Neal.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'll do a quick historical context before we start the public hearing. But from the date that this segment of street was built to connect France Avenue and Halifax, it was originally referred to as Market Street. And that changed on September 13, 1951. Well, it changed on September 24, 1951, when the council held a public hearing after receiving a petition from a group of business owners and tenants from that area, who asked that the name be changed from Market Street to West 49th and a half Street. They submitted a petition. The petition had rationale about there's no market on Market Street. Market Street was being confused with Marquette Avenue in Minneapolis. It didn't have any indication of whether it was north, south, east, or west. They were apparently spending a lot of time explaining to their customers where Market Street is. And it was just an annoyance to them. So they made their case to the city council. It wasn't, there were people that testified both pro and con on the question, but the council voted unanimously to make the change. And on September 24th, 1951, they did change the name of the street that we're talking about tonight from Market Street to West 49th and a half Street. I first raised the question with council about the prospect of changing it back to Market Street earlier this year on January 18th. And the rationale for that change is just the awkwardness of a half street, you know, whether you're saying it verbally, whether you're writing it, because we had been writing it a lot, both in presentations and in narrative form for official purposes. I raised the question with council. There was some interest in pursuing it. Part of pursuing the change of a name of a street in Edina is a public hearing. That public hearing is scheduled for tonight. We have noticed every property that has a West 49th and a half street street mailing address. So they've received a notification of this public hearing and of the purpose of the public hearing. If the council supports after this public hearing the name change, we have to do that by ordinance, and we would present that ordinance to you at our next council meeting, but we have not presumed that you're going to take that action, so it's not prepared for you tonight. And that is my presentation. Be happy to answer any questions.
Questions for Manager Neal?
So, so I assume back at that time, the folks who were looking for places also followed MnDOT signs as to where to go for detours?
I believe it was just as organized then as it is today.
Funny that people couldn't find them then, but yes. they wouldn't have any trouble now.
No.
Member Fisher?
Mr. Neal, can you tell me approximately how many, when you say all the businesses were noticed, how many would that be roughly?
There were 13 property owners that were noticed.
Okay, and they wouldn't necessarily all be businesses, but just owners of property on that street.
Owners of property, and I believe we also, and maybe Ms. Tim can tell me, I believe we also noticed tenants as well. Is that not our standard?
I believe so.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else for Manager Neal at this point in time? Otherwise, I'll open it up for public testimony. So this matter is now open as a public hearing. If you want to come forward and testify, please come forward. You'll have 3 minutes. You'll have 30 seconds left when the yellow light goes on, so you can think about wrapping up your comments.
Okay. Hi, again, sorry I came up earlier, but my name is Lisa Williams, and I'm the owner of Bespoke Hair Artisans on 49th and a half Street, 3918. And Bespoke has been there for 6 years this June. We have about 10,000 clients in our database, and I got real excited when I got the notice because our clients have a tough time finding us, and our mail has a tough time finding us, and our deliveries have a tough time finding us because there's a 3918 West 49th Street that, as much as we try and as much as we've gone to UPS and to you know, the Postal Service, we're lucky we have our own mail delivery guy that helps us sort it, and I met the owners now of 3918, and so there's a lot of confusion around it, and so I think it would be great, and it, you know, each new guest that you have, you've really got to take time to explain to them just where you're at, and with the development happening on the street, I think I hear just a lot of frustration from like my neighbor next door and others. So I just think it'd be a great idea and would be helpful. So just wanted to come here tonight and tell you that. So well,
thank
that's
you, Ms. Williams.
Yep, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
How ironic that
Ms. Williams?
60 years ago, how ironic that 60 years ago they wanted to change it to Market Street because people, or wanted to change it to 49 and a half because people couldn't find them. And now you like to change to Market because people can't find you on 49 and a half. It's come full circle.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. Anyone else wish to testify regarding this proposed change? Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Jim Stromberg. I live at 3930 West 49th and Nothing Street. I would echo the previous speaker in that mail delivery can be a challenge. I know my mailman very well. He laughs many times when we meet at the door, saying that this was supposed to go here, but it went there, and we're getting that all straightened out. The second item is my friends and relatives that look to come to visit me. If they're coming from the north, it's pretty easy. You can just read the numbers as you're going off, and you get 49th, they know to turn. When they're coming from the south, they get to 50th and automatically turn their blinker on for the next intersection that has a stoplight. And then they find that they're in a place where they have to make a left turn on a 49th and a half street. And it is very confusing. The final thing I'd leave you with is that there's a big proposal in front of you or coming at you pretty hard with the redevelopment of 49th and a half. And if there is going to be a change made to the street, this would be the most opportune time to be doing it ahead of the project itself. There aren't too many property owners there at this time compared to what potentially is going to be there with a redevelopment. Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Stromberg, thank you for your thoughts. Anyone else wish to testify regarding this proposed name change? All right. Hearing nothing and seeing no one coming forward, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
We've got a motion and a second to close the public hearing. Discussion. All those in favor of closing the public hearing, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. So you'd like some direction, or at least a conversation amongst council members, and this would require an ordinance change, and if we were to move forward with the proposed change from 49 and a half Street to Market Street, we'd ask you to do
Yes, it
preparation
would.
Of an ordinance for a first reading.
Ordinance, there'd be an ordinance for first reading that would occur on the first meeting in April, the second meeting in April, it would have the second reading. There's a long, as you might guess, a bit of a delay in when this could become effective. We have to notify a number of agencies, USPS and other street naming organizations about this change. We would also want to probably have dual names on street posts for a while. But as Mr. Stromberg mentioned, I felt the same thing. If we are going to go forward with a pretty significant redevelopment, this would be definitely the time to do that. We have received support from those redevelopers. They're very much in support of the name change as well.
Good. Thoughts from council members?
I think it's a great idea. So,
all right.
Yeah.
Succinct.
I like it. So it's a good idea.
Member Stoughton?
I always enjoy the history. I think it's just fascinating and being Excuse able me. To pick up even the petition and the signature from everyone, and then the fact that for different reasons now people are having trouble finding it when that was the original purpose. So I think it's a great idea. It brings back some heritage. Selecting Market Street is not just picking a name out of midair. It's what it was once, and so I think that's an appropriate name.
Member Fisher?
I'm in favor of moving forward and starting the ordinance process. And I think 70 or 80 years from now, when somebody wants to change the name of the street again, they'll look back and hopefully our minutes will be kind of that old typewritten look too, you know? I don't know how ours will look old fashioned, but it will in some way. Then we won't be a holograph, you know? We'll actually have minutes, but.
All right, Member Stewart.
I too am in favor of moving forward, and I will learn to enunciate carefully when I say Marquette or Market.
Very good. I also favor the name change. I think I'd like what Mr. Stromberg had to say. I've been involved in two matters where there have been proposed street name changes, and in both instances we decided not to do it because there were too many people living on the street. One was a single family neighborhood, and I think one was a fairly active commercial neighborhood, and they were really concerned about
we
it.
Haven't
so,
done that.
As Mr. Stromberg points out, this is a perfect time to do it, I favor it as well. So, is there a motion to direct staff to craft an ordinance changing the name of 49 and a half Street to Market Street?
So moved.
Second.
And a motion and a second. Discussion? All those in favor of the motion as stated, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay. Carried. All right. Thank you, Manager Neal.
Thank you.
Next portion of the agenda, reports and recommendations. We had some nice proposed grants to the city that we need to approve on a supermajority basis as required by state law. So if we're going to accept these donations, we need to pass it at the council level on a 4/5 vote. Is there a motion to adopt resolution 2017-17?
So moved.
Second.
And a motion and second to adopt resolution 2017-17. Discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed say nay. Carried. Wonderful tree donation from Andrew and Rebecca Warzak, $1,200 value. The Edina Crime Prevention Fund, wonderful organization that to the Arts Center has donated $8,500 for the Edina Fall into the Arts Festival, and then to the Centennial Lakes, I guess both involved. Gifts of $8,500. Member Brindle, maybe you can explain the distinction.
Yes. There. So the
Member Brindle's on the crime fund.
Yes, I am a member of the Edina Crime Prevention Fund. And the way
that's a better way to put it than you're on the crime fund.
That's right. That's right. We do shorten the name, but it is the crime prevention fund. So the way we have formatted how we use the proceeds from the annual Edina Fall into the Arts Festival is that we take 50% of those proceeds and we put them in the crime fund treasury, which then that those monies get dispersed out to the police department when they request a variety of projects and support for staff projects, et cetera, during the year. And then the other half of those funds are divided evenly. And so of that complete pie, 25% goes to the Art Center and 25% goes to Centennial Lakes Park. So Michael Fry from the Art Center is really the chair of the festival, and so he puts the lion's share of the mission and the work behind the event and making it successful. And the event is held at Centennial Lakes, so we support both of those organizations and thank staff and volunteers for always helping us have a successful, wonderful event.
Thank you, Member Rindle. The next matter in this portion of the agenda is we call it on the agenda Trunk Highway 169 update, but it is much more than that. It's kind of a benign term, but talk about the alternate route 169 through the Parkwood Knolls neighborhood. And Director Milner has some update information for us and some data.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Mayor, members of council. We're in week 9 of the closure of 169. Originally, they were anticipating 40 weeks. I haven't heard anything to say otherwise, so we're almost 25% through the construction of that facility. Last Monday, we did the full closure at Dover and Lincoln at the direction of the council at the last council meeting. We've been monitoring traffic. We have seen some increases on Blake, Interlochen, down near Vernon. Hopkins and Minnetonka have reported some increases in their traffic volumes. I'm not seeing anything at this point from a safety or traffic management standpoint that we should remove that closure. I think it's working well enough. It's done the improvements to the safety of the folks that lived right on that direct route. So I would recommend we stick with the closure. Currently, it's done with movable signs and barrels. What we're seeing is people are moving those signs and barrels around all the time. Even if they're in place, we see cars driving up on the sidewalk to get through or on the boulevards around them. So the reason we didn't use concrete barriers right away last Monday is we just wanted to see what would happen when we closed it. If there was some major issues, then we could move signs and not have to move big concrete barriers. So I'm assuming, unless I hear from the council this evening, I will be contacting MnDOT tomorrow to begin the installation of some concrete barriers there so people can't move them. And we'll get them up onto the boulevard and near the sidewalk so cars can't drive up around on the sidewalk. So unless there's further direction from the council, that's where I would recommend we continue to go.
Thank you, Director Milner. Member Staunton.
Just to... couple of questions just in terms of what, if anything, you've been seeing in terms of the rest of the system. Have you been able to detect kind of where, are there other areas where we're seeing more traffic, whether that be Vernon or Blake Road or the like? Any sense with those?
I have a staff member that lives in the President's neighborhood, so his commute's in and out right in that area. He's noted that he thinks the queues are a little longer than they were before.
But getting out of Maloney and
Blake.
Okay.
In those areas, Maloney, Interlochen, Blake, but nothing that would warrant reopening Dover at this point. We don't have traffic counts.
We don't have any counts, okay.
It's just so difficult
kind of anecdotal
measuring all the time.
All right.
Exactly. And we'll continue to watch it, and if we do see something, we would come back and make recommendations.
Yeah, and I know, you know, I empty out, from the anecdotal perspective, I empty out onto Vernon, you know, closer east to Tracy. And it actually hasn't been worse than, I mean, that's often a bad left turn at rush hour, and I haven't detected it being any worse. So, thank you.
Member Brindle.
Thank you. We did get reports from residents talking about motorists driving up on the sidewalk and on their lawn. So one of the thoughts that I have is we have the mobile surveillance unit in the police department. I don't know if it's being deployed elsewhere currently, but that might help deter people from doing that and driving up around a concrete barrier. The comments we're hearing from residents are that they're being told to go that way by the direction app that they're using. And so it's, you know, if they turn around, if they do a 180, the direction app will adjust and tell them another route, but they seem to be really wanting to follow that app and to the point of driving up on the sidewalk and on someone's lawn. So I'm just wondering if having camera surveillance might help that a little bit.
We can arrange the concrete barriers such that there's no opportunity to go on the grass. There's a concrete railing, bollards and a railing. We're going to put it right up to that, and then on the other side, right up to the sidewalk, and then there's trees and a drop-off. So I'm pretty confident we can get it so narrow that a car can't get through.
Okay. So the school buses have adjusted?
Yep. Hopkins was the most affected by that change,
mm-hmm.
and that was one of the comments you saw come through an email one of the first days.
Right. Well, thank you. We knew this was going to be painful on the residents, and we'll get through this, and we'll get finished with this project, and hopefully back to normal. Traffic certainly isn't the only problem we're hearing about, and so there's some great amount of patience by some of the neighbors on the north end who are seeing damage to their homes from the constant pounding in the ground. So I know that MnDOT has been listening and responding to them as well about that. So thank you.
Thank you. And we will just assume that you will proceed as you determined to do.
All right. Could I just make one comment?
Yes, Member Fisher.
I'm pretty much astounded by the stories I hear about people ignoring all the signage and the barricades and just listening to the little voice. So I'm thinking if we were to put up one more sign, it should say something like, if Siri told you to jump off a bridge, would you do it? And I'm thinking some of them would, but it's just pretty amazing.
Thank you. All right, let's move on to aviation noise update. Member Brindle, you've got some reporting out to do here based on the National League of Cities.
Yes, we attended a noise meeting. Noise is a national lobbying group that is organized out of the Lockridge Grindle Nowen law firm. And we are a member of NOISE. So we met, and there were people from different states there with a variety of concerns. But all of us use what are called these noise contours. And so in each contour, there is a decibel. There's a 75, for example. You go out a little further, there's a 70. You go out a little further, there's a 65, and there's a 60, and there's even a 55, and probably less than that. And these contours are these long, elongated shapes that show where the loudest and quietest of the loudest noises are as an airplane takes off and goes over a neighborhood. And it really is fascinating how all this works. But it's of late in Edina, we are not hearing many complaints, noise complaints at this time. And it turns out that many of the jets that are taking off from MSP Airport are taking off currently to the south. And it may be the winds that are causing that, but it's moving the noise to Burnsville and Apple Valley and parts of Eagan. And that is where the noise complaints are happening right now. So, you know, in an ideal situation, we would all have our share. And so that's really what we are lobbying for, is equity. And we want the airport to be convenient. It's a transportation necessity. It's an economic necessity. And so being sensitive to all of that, We are just looking for no community being inconvenienced any more than any other. And there's a whole host of things. And if you are interested in being part of the conversation, please go and visit MSP Fair Skies. That's a local group that has a lot of information on its website that you can learn from, and you can become associated with MSP Fair Skies. This is a group that works hard. They ask good questions, and the Noise Oversight Committee does. They are sensitive. They are prompt in responding. So it's really, we are very, one thing I learned at the noise meeting by listening to some people from Southern California was that they have 5 airports, and they do not have an airport commission, like a Metropolitan Airport Commission, which we have here. And so when a jet comes by and it's low and it's loud, they want to complain, but they have to complain to the right airport, and they don't know which airport to complain to, and they don't have an airport commission. So I realized then that not everybody's got a Metropolitan Airports Commission, and how lucky we are that our area was organized in the way that it is, because they are responsible for hearing our complaints, hearing our wants, and putting together a noise oversight committee that we can use as a resource for our communities to be heard on noise, on the health effects of noise, et cetera. So, in essence, we're in very good position, I think, for having our voices heard.
Thank you. Manager Neal, or any other observations by council members that attended the session?
No, I think once again it was a good session. We had some new faces in the audience. Mm-hmm. There are a couple new cities, particularly around the Bay Area in San Francisco, who we have not seen before. But some of the folks who we have grown accustomed to seeing from the Boston area and the Atlanta area, around Louisville, around Phoenix. We're getting to know them better and being able to collaborate with them better as well.
Good. Thank you. All right, moving on to mayor and council comments. Member Stewart, would you lead us off, please?
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just looking back on the calendar here, on Wednesday, March the 8th, there was a report on the state of the river, meaning the state of the Mississippi River. This was an event sponsored by the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District. And it is reassuring to see how the focus on this issue and the work that has been done by the various watershed districts that all feed into the Mississippi and by the greater Mississippi communities have really helped improve the health of the river in many measurable ways. There are some threats, of course, the Asian carp and some other invasive species are continuing to be challenges. But much of the chemical and bio contaminants in the waters, those measures have improved dramatically. So, and there's a lot of work that's ongoing. So it's good to hear that. We have a long way to go yet, but there's good work being done. March 11th through 15th, the 5 of us attended the meeting of the National League of Cities in Washington, D.C. We go there to, I think, learn what's sort of happening among our other cities, what kinds of sort of state-of-the-art things are people doing in cities to, I think, keep up with whether it's technology changes or societal changes. So that's all very good. But also while we're out there, we get a chance to visit with each of our congressional representatives in the Senate and the House of Representatives and or their staffs. And I think it's valuable for us as a city to have really healthy relationships with our representatives in Washington, D.C. Then on Saturday, May 18th, Member Fisher and I substituted for the mayor in the monthly walk with the mayor. We had a really nice group of citizens who met with us at Southdale, and we talked at some length about a number of issues that are of interest to them. And then on a personal note, I will say, if you organize an NCAA pool, you want me in your pool. I just donate $10 and it's done. My brackets are so busted so fast. So I'm just a net contributor every year. And I think NCAA coaches should pay me to not pick their team. Duke and Villanova, thank you for letting me support you this year. Coming up here, there's a meeting regarding the Southdale Library at the Southdale Library on Thursday, the 23rd of March. Then on Monday, April the 3rd, I believe, we have an annual event. Many of our really great organizations in our community that have a lot of volunteers and help improve our community through volunteer work bring groups, and we get to recognize them at our annual volunteer recognition event. So that's all I've got. Thank you.
Member Brindel.
Thank you. A couple of things. I attended, along with the rest of us, the National League of Cities Conference in Washington, D.C. And as part of that, we went to Capitol Hill and visited all of our legislators' offices. And on Wednesday, that was the first day of another conference in Washington, D.C. at the Hyatt. And it was the Community Action Foundation conference. And I sit on the board for Community Action. Now it's been renamed Community Action Partnership of Hennepin County. And so I went to the first day of that conference, and Bernie Sanders was the keynote speaker. So it was a terrific opportunity to hear a very dynamic gentleman speak his heart. And he was followed up by several legislators, Republican and Democrat, and talking about funding, CDBG funding, and how important it is, and community action and the work of community action, and how important it is. The work of community action supports people who live in poverty. So one of the most commonly known programs in community action is energy assistance, so that people are not without heat in the wintertime. So, but there are many more other programs, foreclosure prevention and budgeting and a whole host of things, tax preparation. And then also transportation, getting to work. That's that. Earlier in community comment, we heard about 44th Street. I want to know why it would be a council issue whether to provide an exception to no parking on 44th Street.
I think it's actually an issue that extends beyond 44th Street.
We had
this issue up by Highlands. I think, Chief, I can't remember last year, we had some folks that we adjusted. It was up on Blake Road, wasn't it?
There were a couple of them up in that neighborhood.
That wanted to have an exception to the general rule of no parking on both sides of the street because they had events, neighborhood events. And Manager Neal, you may want to address this issue.
I think I can ask Mr. Milner to chime in as well. But really, it comes down to what you might think it does, and that is that we received calls from people who were opposed to staff taking the discretion to bag the signs. And as we processed that, there was a lot of discussion about who has the right to abridge a council, a previous council action to put a no parking sign on a place in a neighborhood. And we got down to the point where it didn't look like that we probably had that discretion as staff. So, Mr. Milner, do you want to chime in on that, please?
Yeah, it came through the Traffic Safety Committee, so I guess just a few other things we talked about there with Lieutenant Convoy, the workload. They were getting a lot of requests, and they had to process those requests, send somebody out from PD to process. And again, some were done, some weren't. So there really wasn't a policy in place either, so it was really inconsistent. And then the third, there's no parking signs are there for a reason. It's a safety reason with the space available on a road. Many of those state aid routes, like 44th, were set by the state on those guidance of where we have no parking and where we don't. And we get funding to pay for a reconstruction of those streets. So to arbitrarily start covering up those things in certain events just goes outside the lines of how that was initially designed. So that's kind of what we talked about with traffic safety and just felt like it was time to stop that practice.
Well, what do we do when someone is going to have an event and there isn't enough convenient parking?
They're going to have to travel a little bit further. There's other routes. They mentioned in the example 44th, they're stealing.
Yeah.
Brookside. They may have to drop somebody off at the house and have somebody that can walk a little further, park the car. There's many streets where there is no parking. We don't get requests, and they make it work.
Right. Right.
So,
I know it.
I know it's been done in the past, but we got to the point where it was just
too much.
Well,
there aren't that many cross streets, actually, along 40. Well, there are some, I guess. But, and then we don't have any district parking at 44th and France, but depending upon where you are at 44th, on 44th, that's quite a jaunt.
I mean, we have these all over town. We were getting requests agency-wide, so some it's easy to have adjacent parking, some it's not. You know, Valley View Road is one down near your area where people would want to do the same thing, and we told them it's not done anymore.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Member Staunton.
So how does this differ from closing off streets for a block party kind of event, those kinds of things? Is that just a different type of street that we permit that on, or is it?
Nope.
Yeah, we're actually closing the street for that event versus covering no parking signs. I guess I'm not familiar how that gets selected on Night to Unite. You know, there's barricades go up to make a request. There's a request through the Public Works, and those are reviewed.
And I get that those aren't generally collector streets. They're more of the side streets.
Typically, those have parking. So we're just closing it down for a couple hours for an event organized by the neighborhood.
Right, and then a whole bunch of neighbors have gotten together and said they don't want the street open for that night. I'm sympathetic to the issue. I understand, you know, especially being on a busy street like the Wellness are on, and or busier street, and if you want to have visitors, and especially when we've had a tradition of kind of working around this from time to time. It sounds like it's a more challenging issue than it seems like on its face, but.
Right, when nobody cared, it wasn't a big deal, but we had a rash of people caring last year, and
who
really,
were the drivers or
no other? The people who were opposed to those signs being bagged. They felt they had concerns about what we were doing and why we were doing it.
And were they people who lived in those neighborhoods, or were there people passing through who thought that the traffic
they
was,
were both.
Okay. Yep. All right, well, appreciate that feedback. I'm not sure what we can do about it, but.
Is there some way to deal with that issue other than bagging? I know it's a multi-pronged issue, but I'm empathetic, too, to this notion that once in a while somebody might have a neighborhood party like they did up on Blake Road, and they're stymied as to what to do. And up on Blake Road, I guess you can go over on Maloney, and there's a couple of other side streets in Interlochen Park, but it's complicated. You know, you want to let people enjoy their neighborhoods too, and have people park in a convenient way. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
And one of those, and I can't remember if it's one on Blake Road, but they were having multiple parties a year. It was some of them were fundraisers, so they had a lot of people, but it wasn't just a once a year sort of thing, and it was a long stretch as well.
Would it be necessary to bag the signs? I mean, people parked there, and the PD knew that it was we were allowing parking there for an event. Do the signs need to be bagged?
Well, I think that was as much for the guests as it was for the PD.
That could be an issue that a host could handle, saying, you know, you can park on 44th Street, eastbound 44th Street, for example.
Mayor and council members, if people were not paying attention to the no parking signs because they're having a special event there, if we get other people calling and complaining that there's vehicles parked at the no parking signs, we would have a difficult time saying, well, for this occasion, we're not going to enforce. Residents calling in complaining about that, we would be enforcing the no parking signs.
Okay, all right, well, I think some of us are inclined to give it some more thought,
yeah.
But complicated. More complicated than it seems on the surface, I guess. And for an old law enforcement person, former law enforcement person,
yeah.
I think Mr. Wellna understands the complication. All right, Member Brindle, anything else on your?
Mm-mm. All That's
right.
It.
Member Stotten?
Well, that was one of the issues I wanted to bring up, so thank you, Member Brindle, for bringing that up.
Sure.
And then the only other thing is I just wanted to thank our residents for sponsoring our travel to Washington, D.C. for the National League of Cities Conference. I think it's, I'm really pleased that we have an opportunity to do this as somebody who sits on the board of the League of Minnesota Cities. I'm really acutely aware of the value of collaborating with other people who are in similar situations to us, and I get that from my work on the league board. But when we go to D.C., I'm always amazed. I come back, and you have so many experiences with people who are wrestling with similar issues in places all over the country. We, you know, had lunch with some folks from Florida. We had dinner with a council member from Madison, Wisconsin, who was in a session with Mike Fisher and I on Saturday. And everybody just has such different perspectives, and I think they're really valuable. Mike and I had a chance to participate in a session on Saturday that was sponsored by the Urban Land Use Institute. Terrific kind of hands-on session where we really had a chance, I'm sure Mike will share his thoughts too, to wrestle with some of the development issues that we have to wrestle with as a council and kind of look at them through the other end of the telescope. We were asked to sit in teams of people who were supposed to be developing property in response to a request for proposals from a city. And each of us was supposed to play a different role of neighborhood liaison or city liaison or finance person or marketing person. And it was fascinating to watch the way that people tackled that and to gain an appreciation for the challenges that go into that process. So I thought that was a real highlight for me. I got a real appreciation for the dynamics in that situation.
And you two were on different teams, and whose team won?
Yeah. I Mr. Fisher, it's going to be a long time. Next year can't come fast enough, I guess. But it was a great experience and a whole bunch of other things. I could go into many others. I agree that the opportunity to connect with our legislators is really valuable. I will say that from a league perspective, one of the decisions we made as a league board this year was to become more active with our federal advocacy. And so in addition to the city touching base with legislators, we as members of the league board and others who were there touched base as well. And I know Member Stewart and I had a chance to participate in a visit with Congressman Ellison's staff as part of that as well. So I think it's a really valuable, and I just want people in the community to know that how much we appreciate having the chance to do it. I think it makes us better at what we do for our community and bring better ideas and understand better ways to do things. And I'm glad to live in a community that values that and sees the value in making that effort. So thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Member Stotten. Member Fisher?
So I'll just take off from where
Council Member... Touchdown dance?
Yeah.
where Councilmember Staunton left off. As the new person on this council, you know, this is one of the first things that came to my attention is that this happens every, I think, couple of years, and or has. And I was questioning, you know, is this a good value for the taxpayers? Is it, do we get enough out of it? You know, from this perspective, and also, you know, do you want to take vacation from your job without your family to go someplace and you know, spend time learning for the council job? And I will say, you know, I quizzed all of you about it. Certainly, Mr. Neal, I asked a lot of questions, you know, is there value? You all said there was, trust all of you, and you were all right on the money. Man, I learned a lot. And just some of the highlights, Council Member Staunton talked about the urban plan. It was a full day session, and the takeaway there is that when you're dealing with development and developers and our residents and we're talking about these things, the language we need to start using is trade-offs. Because everything we do is a trade, you know, if we don't do this, there's a trade-off, or if we do this. And starting to use a language that involves everyone and helps everyone be part of that conversation, I think, is a really big deal. Council Member Stewart and I attended a first-tier suburbs council, which was a lunch meeting one day. And I think I went in there thinking that I was going to see a whole bunch of people that were in cities like ours, first-tier suburbs, and we'd be talking about issues and talk about an eye-opener or a wake-up call or something. The issues that typical first-ring suburbs are dealing with, if you all recall the statistics we got earlier tonight about crime in Edina, we would have been laughed out of that room, right? I mean, they're dealing, most of these first-tier suburbs are dealing with some pretty serious and heavy issues that we are in a respect, but nothing to the magnitude of what's going on in a lot of first-ring suburbs. I would say one of the most valuable, and if you haven't gathered this, you know, we split up and tried to cover everything we could as a council. I went to what was called agency roundtables. They had 28 agencies represented in a big ballroom, and you got 20 minutes at a table, and you got three to choose from. And I chose Department of Homeland Security, National Park Service, and U.S. Department of Justice. And so I learned a lot about cybersecurity, and there's actually quite a bit of funding and support for proactive and reactive cybersecurity issues. So I've got a lot of information I'll be sharing with staff. National Park Service, I learned a lot about historic preservation and all the support there is for that. And the U.S. Department, I stopped with the U.S. Department of Justice. I wanted to learn a lot more. Probably the thing I know least about is sort of the police and cops programs and all that kind of stuff. So it was really informative. And what was really interesting about it is it's beyond, you know, there's a lot of community policing and funding for all that, but there's also programs, as we get into this race and equity task force, and even it's beyond police, you know, it's community. There is actually funding out there for innovation. So if a community, if we start plugging up or plugging ideas and our committees start coming up with things that we might experiment or try, we may be able to get funding to actually support that, because they're looking for communities that are trying to be leaders. So if we come up with great ideas, that it could be happening in other places. Those are all really interesting things to learn. I'd say the big takeaways for me, there was a mayor of a southern community that had some pretty compelling stories about the issues in his town. And I'll probably always remember this, because I'm the newly elected official here that I keep thinking, well, in my mind, I think, well, that happened before I was elected. I didn't vote on that, right? And man, he looked right, and this is a big room, 2,000 people. He looked right in the camera and said, the things that my community was challenging me on, he's like, in my head, I'm like, I wasn't even on the council. I wasn't the mayor then. I was running a business. But what he learned is that when you're elected, you own it. You own the history. You own everything. And that was really just so compelling to me. And it really flipped a switch for me that everything we've done in the past, we own it right here. And it came true literally 2 days later. I came back, and I was at the Strockhauer Park Neighborhood Board meeting. And these are some of the same people that had my yard signs. So there's no way they could forget about the fact that I just got elected. And they were razzing me about decisions the city made like a year ago, 2 years ago. I'm like, and all I could think of was this mayor saying that. I'm like, he is so right. You know, we own it. We're here. So that was, it was a great takeaway. And the other thing, the takeaway was that cities really have to lead on a lot of issues right now because there's a bit of a void of leadership at other levels. And something that is really in my on my mind a lot. And the third and last thing is it was amazing to watch a city kind of shut down with 3 inches of snow. And that was interesting to experience that, you know, things we take for granted, you know, how we just motor through that stuff. So that was an experience in itself. So thanks. Yeah,
good. Thanks for those comments. I also want to thank you, Member Fisher and Member Stewart, for covering walk with the mayor for me. I kind of panicked that morning looking at the time zone changes and called Mike, and it was right at 9 o'clock, and oh yeah, you were there, Bob was there, he said, and I could hear people chatting in the background, and so I thank both of you for covering a walk with the mayor for me on the 18th. The National League of Cities session, on a personal note, Member Stewart and I had some of his law school classmates on Friday night. We got there late, but Friday night they waited for us for supper at one of his Virginia law school classmates' homes, and we had a wonderful conversation with some people, including a former Chief Justice Rehnquist's daughter was in attendance, another classmate of Member Stewart's. The next day, you know, you've heard that all of us were in what they call National League of Cities University on Saturday, and Manager Neal and I ended up, as we tried to move around and cover different areas, we ended up in the race and equity session in, that took the entire afternoon, and that was a fascinating experience as well. And a lot of folks from southern states, a lot of African-American political leaders from various communities all the way across the country. And getting their perspective on running towns, as folks have alluded to, was quite fascinating. And then participating in some of the exercises with them that the staff was running. And Member Staunton's, actually the group that was running it, is running this government alliance on race equity here in the state of Minnesota, Seattle-based, I think. And she was there along with a couple of people there and did a very good job. And then other sessions that I attended included transportation. Many of our council members were there as well. I felt like I was fairly tuned into the transportation issues on a federal level because of my work at the TAB. So I ducked out of there after a while and went to the session on energy and the environment, and that was also valuable. And as Member Fisher has been talking about here, and one of the comments he made was cities are being asked to lead on more and more issues, things that we think might be state issues, federal issues. So it'll be interesting to see how people come to us that we represent and ask us to look at certain issues that are going to be important to them and how we deal with some of these things. And I think we just need to keep an open mind as to whether we think it's an appropriate path to walk on a particular issue or not. And let's see, thanks for pointing out that meeting at the Southdale Library coming up. And then Thursday night, with the help of Manager Neal putting some material together for me on Grandview, I'm going to be over at the Humphrey Institute. They asked me to come over as a local elected official to talk about the role of infrastructure and economic development. So I thought, well, we've got local examples. They had some materials they sent to me that had been put together by the city of New York during the time Bloomberg was the mayor, and I thought, well, let's get something a little bit more relevant from a size standpoint, and we can talk about that. So that'll be an interesting time as well. And then, let's see, Monday morning, Manager Neal and Member Fisher and I met with the folks that are working on the acquisition of the school bus district property, and that was an interesting conversation as well. So that's it for me. Manager Neal.
Mr. Mayor, you didn't explain why the flight that you and I were on was delayed on Friday. But
I liked your characterization, how we had a layover in Minneapolis.
we Member Staunton would tell you that it was because I was testing karma, because I was reading the book Sully as we were taking off. We apparently had a very large goose fly into one of the engines. That goose gave his life, but we ended up having to turn around, land at MSP, get a new airplane, get a new crew, and many hours later, we were able to return to the sky. So I will learn to not test karma in the future.
Yeah, he was reading Sully, and he was reading the part of the book where they had the bird strike when we had the goose end up in the right-hand engine, which ground to a halt. The plane shuddered. The smell came into the cabin, and...
And we were greeted when we landed back at MSP by a runway lined with fire trucks. So.
All right, Manager Neal.
I find it hard to follow that, and I don't really have anything else to add other than the National League of Cities conference was really a great opportunity for me as well, and for all the same reasons that that you listed, and I appreciate being able to go. Thank you.
All right. There was one matter on the agenda we are not covering this evening because we are going to go finish our work on this particular topic, and that is the city manager's performance review. So that's not going to be addressed on the agenda this evening. It'll be addressed at a subsequent time, I imagine 2 weeks from now. All right. Anything else that prompted anything from anyone else? Manager Neal.
So I think, Your Honor, that the Mr. City Attorney could help us here too. I think the appropriate action at this point is to adjourn this meeting and then to reconvene the recessed closed session. Is that?
You're going to do that?
Yeah, we're doing it yet this evening.
Oh yes. Yeah. Then you would adjourn this meeting, and
reconvene the session. Yeah, the closed session.
Yes. Although, shouldn't we go up
we're,
to the
we're
room
still,
where we can
record? We went back into open session.
Right. And you adjourned. We recessed the closed meeting
it.
Until after this meeting.
We continued it until after.
Yeah, we continued it.
Recessed it, yes. Yeah. Okay.
We did.
And you can do it right here in this space if you want to.
You can do where you want.
Or you can go back up to the community.
I think we should go back up.
Okay.
It's a little bit easier to talk to each other.
Very good.
All right. Anything further? So we are I'll entertain a motion to adjourn the council meeting and reconvene the council. Let's see. How would we do that?
Then you're going to reconvene the work session.
Reconvene the work session upstairs. Adjourn the council meeting. Is there a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Second.
All right. Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say nay. Carried. Stand adjourned.